Today I would like to share with you some of my general observations concerning the Bronze Age economic model of the Near East and Eastern Mediterranean societies and the ways of involvement of South Caucasian in these processes. Of course, it's quite a big theme, but since we don't have time, so I will try somehow to shrink it and to present kind of summary. For this purpose, I will focus, first of all, on the development of bronze metallurgy, since it seems that exactly the trade of bronze component metals shaped this particular economic model. It was not merely the technical superiority of tin bronze over stone, obsidian, or arsenic copper, and iron over tin bronze that conditioned the epoch-making economic and socio-cultural transformations in the ancient world, introducing first the Bronze Age and then the Iron Age economic systems. The introduction of tin bronze in the Near East and Eastern Mediterranean, in addition to arsenic copper, whose physical characteristics were good enough to satisfy the needs of ancient men, cannot be explained by the limited resources of tin, allowing certain groups of people to monopolize tin supply and benefit from the long-distance international trade relations. The prosperity of complex societies of the 3rd and the 2nd millennium BCE in the Near East and Eastern Mediterranean hinged just on an economic system based on a model of hard-to-get, easy-to-monopolize natural resources. Some scholars believe the reason for the introduction of tin bronze was to avoid the poisoning features of arsenic. However, it is hard to believe that ecological and healthcare awareness was higher in the Bronze Age societies than what we have now, or that fears about the negative health effects of arsenic would have been sufficient to discourage people from its use. And indeed, arsenic bronze was never fully displaced by tin bronze and was produced through the late bronze, early Iron Age in sufficient quantities. Here is one example for your consideration. This is a belt buckle from the 13th century BC found at Trelli Cemetery in Tbilisi, imaging a horseman and his horse, both with quite peculiar attributes. This belt buckle is made of tin bronze, but inlaid with arsenic copper, containing up to 30% of arsenic. I am referring to the silvery geometric figures, both on the body of. Whether early tin was coming from Afghanistan, Anatolia, Iran, Central Asia, or elsewhere, it seems that the limited tin supplies throughout the Near East became the main impetus for the introduction of tin bronze in addition to arsenic copper. As for the answer to the question, why was it necessary to invent tin bronze when tin deposits were limited in the Near East? The answer is apparently as simple as this, because tin was limited. Despite new evidence from Central Asia and Iran of ancient tin mining that has widened the geography of tin deposits used for the Near Eastern prehistoric bronzes, And even if more are to be discovered, the fact remains that tin resources were limited and their limited geographic scope required the material to be transported across great distances. The benefits of limited resources were clear for the pre-Bronze Age societies in the case of obsidian and even in the case of materials that had no utilitarian or intrinsic value. Let me give an example. Among the various precious stones, lapis lazuli was the most limited in the Near East and apparently the primary one that gave rise to very long distance trade. It appeared in Mesopotamia during the late Ubaid period, apparently imported from the Badakhshan mines of Afghanistan, and also in Egypt during the pre-dynastic Nahad II period, which appears in association with other foreign elements linking Mesopotamian trade routes to Egypt. Lapis lazuli beads have also been found in the 4th millennium kurgans of both South and North Caucasia. In Soyuk Bulak, investigated by Bertil Lyonet in Azerbaijan and Maikop, respectively, showing connections to the South Caucasian, South Mesopotamia of the late Ubaid period and the period of the so-called Uruk expansion that, according to some scholars, was conditioned by the interest of Mesopotamians in finding metal sources. As Barbara Helming points out, any models on the tin trade link it to the trade in other precious and prestigious materials with restricted and known provenances. Since lapis lazuli was apparently coming from Afghanistan, and tin was also available in Afghanistan, it stands to reason that the tin in the early 4th millennium bronze items found at the settlement of Delisi in Tbilisi and also in the Talin Kurgan in Armenia, dated to circa 3000 BCE, might have been also of Afghan origin. At the same time, we probably should not discount the existence of a certain level of tin deposits in South Caucasia, which would have been identifiable and available to ancient local miners experimenting with metals. Since our recent discovery at the Treli Cemetery in Tbilisi, I will not be surprised if the ancient tin mines appear also in the Caucasus region. This women's grave from the 8th, 7th centuries BCE, among various artifacts, including gold temple rings, some rounded object was discovered, which appeared an ingot of a pure tin. However, even in the case of discovery of ancient tin mines in the Caucasus, as I already mentioned above, tin was a limited material that required to be transported across great distances. It would have given rise to complex societies, development of bureaucracy and writing system in order to organize trade between remote countries. The third millennium texts from Ebla and from Akkadian period Nippur Telasmar, Kish, Lagash, and Nuzi demonstrated the existence of a centralized economy, the involvement of a central administration in procurement, production, and consumption. The commercial penetration of central Anatolia during the Old Assyrian period results from the monopoly which Ashur experienced on the transport of tin to Anatolia. Occurrence of tin in the Old Assyrian commercial texts from Kültepe-Kanish more frequently than other metals indicate the leading role of tin in the Near Eastern Bronze Age long-distance trade model. According to these texts, tin brought from Ashur was exchanged to silver and the latter to gold. Gold is another example of a limited resource. It is most rare among metals used in prehistoric times with a high prestigious value. In this respect, the most interesting discovery of recent times, as you all know, is the earliest known gold mining site in southern Georgia at Sakdrisi, investigated by the joint team of the Georgian National Museum and the Bochum Bergbau Museum, directed by Irina Gambashidze and Andreas Hauptmann. Among dozens of shafts of the site, to date, only one shaft has been investigated, and its radiocarbon dates range from circa 3300 BCE to 2700 BCE, and about 100 to 120 kilograms of gold must have been extracted from just this one shaft. But the question is, who were the customers, who this gold was mined for? No single gold artifact is found within the archaeological assemblages of the contemporaneous to the Sakdrisi mine early Kurar Axis culture. On the other hand, judging from the settlement and the cemetery associated with this gold mine, apparently mainly Kurar-Axians were mining the site. Therefore, we can assume that they were mining it for export. Gold objects in South Caucasia are appearing since the so-called early early Kurgans of this region, showing relations with the complex societies of the Near East and Eastern Mediterranean. The wealth of these Kurgans is comparable to those in the Near East that are defined in literature as royal tombs or royal graves. Although we do not have textual indications of the involvement of South Caucasia in the long-distance trade relations, such involvement is becoming evident through archaeological data. Let me please give you some, in my point of view, obvious examples. The openwork gold pectoral from the Ananauri Kurgan in eastern Georgia features the technique of filigree used in the Near East since the early dynastic Third A period. Beside the pectoral, the Ananauri necklace also consists of three pendants with double spirals twisted to form conical shapes similar to those of the quadruple spiral pendant from the early dynastic Third A period from the Royal Cemetery at Ur. Although, like most Kurgans of Trialeti in southern Georgia, the Kurgan 14 was looted in antiquity, a few remaining grave goods from this Kurgan still distinctly demonstrate the involvement of Trialetians in long-distance interconnections during the second half of the third millennium BCE. This Kurgan contained an Egyptian carnelian amulet in the shape of a human leg, The Carnelian etched bead from Indus Valley and three amber beads plausibly from the Baltic region. Amber, together with lapis lazuli, appears among the inlays of a gold goblet from the Triallettic Urban 17, which also is decorated with filigree volutes in the shape of sea waves, finding parallels both in other Triallettic artifacts, artifact decorations, and in Middle Minoan third B ware from the Aegean. This pithos with the same kind of relief spiral ornament as shown above and similar to the one from Knossos was found in the Middle Bronze Age Kurgan in Tbilisi together with the shell of Mediterranean origin. The anchor type X offers additional evidence for interactions between South Caucasia and the Near East at the end of the 3rd millennium BCE. Among less than 20 samples found throughout the Near East and Egypt, three come from South Caucasia, one from Bedeni Kurgan in South Georgia, and two from Armenia, from Ijevan and Karashamp, though the one from Karashamp is made of silver. The images of the silver goblets from Karashamp and Triallettic show proximity with impressions of Anatolian seals of the Assyrian colonization period found at Kültepe-Kanesh. However, they stand quite close to early Mesopotamian iconography. South Caucasia was not only involved in long-distance trade relations, but was also instigating some technological and morphological innovations in metalworking. Appearing long-thrusting bronze swords with high midribs, so-called rapiers, within the Triallettic culture, and later in the Aegean, is the most striking evidence for this. Although South Caucasian rapiers are older than the earliest Aegean swords, long swords, it seems unlikely that they would have been developed independently. The complexity of combat technique needed to acquire the intricate art of fencing apparently excludes the possibility of independent development of rapiers in South Caucasia and the Aegean. Virtually identical to the copper cauldron from Kurgan, virtually identical to the copper cauldron from Kurgan 15 of Triallettic comes from the shaft grave 4 at Mycenae. Aside from their similarity in shape and size, both cauldrons also feature close technical characteristics. The bronze bucket from Triallettic Kurgan 15 is similar in shape and roughly the same size as this silver bucket from shaft grave 5 at Mycenae. A similar bucket with a low ring base but with exactly the same system of fixing the handle comes from the intermediate Kültepe Karum Kanesh 2. A bronze vessel with a spool handle Found among the grave goods of the Kirovakan Kurgan in Armenia is an additional evidence for interactions between Trialeti and the Aegean. Vessels with spool handles feature the so-called Wafio-type vessels appearing in the Aegean since the Middle Minoan Third Period and the Mycenaean shaft graves. However, the earlier specimen comes from the Nato treasure in Upper Egypt. As Alan Davis noted, a pottery fragment from Kültepe Kanish, Karun Kanish II, which is approximately contemporaneous with the Thoth treasure, has a vertical spool handle, and the most likely provenance of this type of vessels is Anatolia. Except the vessels with spool handles, Thoth treasure produced also so-called cantharos-shaped pottery, which also links to the Aegean and also to southern Caucasian. Now, as for the Late Bronze Age, I think in this site, which I was lucky to excavate together with Professor Winfried Ortmann, indicates to involvement of southern Caucasus in the long-distance trade relations during the Late Bronze Age. This site, there were huge buildings discovered on this site. The radiocarbon dates for the two horizons of the site are between 19th and 13th centuries in the BCE. It had also the fortification wall around this settlement. And in my point of view, these big buildings, they were not just dwellings, but perhaps the kind of warehouses, and apparently this was also kind of a trading center. It was the site was left by the population around the 13th century BC. Which actually this is the period which coincides with the with the so-called catastrophe in the Near East and the Near Eastern and the Eastern Mediterranean around the 1200 in the BCE, apparently this catastrophe, in my point of view, was connected to the economic reasons rather than eruptions other ecological reasons, which some scholars are coming up with this kind of ideas. It is quite interesting that this building had wooden posts, which were built in the walls, and the only parallel which I could find, it is again Kültepe Kanish Karum, where we have exactly the same architecture like at Sajoge. Excuse me, please. I think it's it's time to finish. Yeah. Sorry, I wasn't able to to make it shorter. And maybe if you have some questions, I can elaborate more. Just to summarize it, so in my point of view, Southern Caucasia was one because of its natural resources, was the region which was rich with metal resources, and that's why there was an interest in Southern Georgia from the complex societies of the Near East and Eastern Mediterranean, and the prosperity of the Middle Bronze Age, especially of the Bronze Age cultures in Southern Caucasia, is apparently based exactly, and the wealth, their wealth of these kurgans is based exactly on this, that they were trading apparently metals outside of southern Caucasia.